Welcome him.
Praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Well, let's make our declaration of excellence in this year of excellence. Are you ready? Say with me, out of Zion, the perfection of beauty, God shines forth. The Lord, my God, causes the righteous to shine forth as the sun. His awesome hand has formed me. His creative spirit inspires my mind. He skillfully guides my hands. Therefore, I boldly declare, I am set apart for excellence. The ruler of the universe has exalted my horn among the nations. He sets my feet on high. In his strength, I rise. By faith, I press forward towards the prize of my highest calling. I believe in my heart and confess with my mouth that Jesus is Lord. He is the vine. I am the branch. In him I abide. In him I blossom. As it is written, God, who commanded light out of darkness, has shown his light in our hearts. We have his treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellence of the power may be of God and not of us. In this year, I commit to excellence. I commit to exceptionalism. I commit to do the extraordinary. In Jesus' name, amen. And amen and amen and amen. And you may be seated wherever you are at home. Or wherever you find yourself this morning, it's a great joy to come to you with the word of God and to encourage you as we serve the Lord in this very interesting season of life. Last week, we concluded our 40 days of power on Monday, and what a glorious time we've had waiting on the Lord for 40 days. And with prayer and fasting, we've had prayer chains going on, people praying all over the world with us. We pray for every nation of the world, and we thank God for the release of the Holy Spirit that has come as a result of that. And we concluded on Monday night with an anointing service, and had a very powerful time in the presence of the Lord. And for those of you who have been following us online, we did a throwback of Greater Works 2019. You've seen some of the footage in our praise and worship and in our hymnals, but we played out everything that happened at Greater Works last year, the praise and worship, the music, the messages, and what an awesome time it's been. And we are very expectant for 2021 Greater Works at the Independence Square, as we normally do. We trust God that Mr. Corona will be no more, and that God will give us the victory as we celebrate him openly and freely without any fear and without any concern. So 2021, Greater Works, it's a date. And just to also let you know, as we announced, beginning from next Sunday, 16th of August, ICGC is starting a gradual in-person service option. Now, we will continue with our online service as we do it. At the same time, this service, you see, will continue and minister to you, but in addition to that, we are offering the option for those who want to be in a church building in any of our churches. Please consult your local church, pastor. Consult your app, and you would know the times and the schedule for your particular local assembly. Just to let you know that not every church is opening. There is a criteria. There are criteria for opening, and when the churches meet it, then they are given their certification to open and gradually opening. So if your church is not ready to open, you wait, they will prepare and get open. But if your church is ready to open, they will give you the time when you should be meeting. For those of you who worship at Christ Temple, we will continue online as it is, but we are offering the option for an in-person service on Sundays beginning from next week at 10:30 in the morning. 10:30 to 11:30, it's going to be 1 hour and only one service. We're working our way to master it and make sure that safety is our utmost concern. We want you to be safe. We know you want to worship, but we don't want dead worshipers. And neither do we want sick worshipers. We want people who worship God in spirit and in truth and in health. So we're going to work our way to ensure that you have a safe environment to worship in. So there will be only one service to start with, and we'll watch and see how it goes. But the online service is available. You can partake of it, and there's no pressure to either go online or be in person. You choose the one that you're most comfortable with and be part of it. Well, I mean, if you've been following, much of my message has been to indicate that we have entered a new season in the in our lives, and God wants us to plant and to build. And I believe that this season is ordained by God. Although the circumstances have been traumatizing, I believe that the hand of God is upon our lives and upon our earth, and God is working out His purposes and bringing us to perfection in His will. So my message today is simply titled, It's a New Season. It's a New Season. Our life on earth is subject to change. If you've lived long enough, by now you know that life is subject to change. The earth itself physically rotates and revolves constantly. The earth is constantly turning. It's interesting that we live on this earth and think it's stable, but in reality, it's a big ball in the sky, hanging, driven by gravity, that is constantly in motion. And because of that, there are changes in season on our earth. But spiritually, God is also constantly changing things. And we have to know when God is indicating a change one way or the other, because the way we respond to that will determine how effectively we live our lives. So there are changes in the seasons of God. Daniel made that observation in Daniel chapter 2, verse 20 and 21. Daniel indicated that God changes seasons. It says, Daniel answered and said, "Blessed be the name of God forever and ever, for wisdom and might are His. And He changes the times and the seasons. He removes kings and raises up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding." The part I want you to note is He changes the times and the seasons. So God changes times and seasons. And it's important when times and seasons change to recognize it. Now, normally we recognize it when the times and seasons change. If we were in a temperate region, there'll be four seasons of winter, spring, summer, and autumn or fall. In our part of the world, it's two main seasons. It's either raining or it's not raining, rainy season or dry season. But in between, there are nuanced changes. Also, although we are now in the dry season in Ghana, relatively our weather is a bit cold at this time. So weather changes. But weather is not the only thing that changes. God's dealing with us also goes through changes. And we have to recognize when God is indicating a change in seasons. A season is not the same as a circumstance. Having a change in circumstance is not the same as having a change in season. A circumstance is very different. A circumstance is, for example, when it rains, the ground will get wet, will get muddy. And that's a circumstance. It's an event or an activity tied to an event. Because it has rained, the ground will get wet. That's a circumstance. That's not a season. And if you wait till the next morning, the ground will dry. So when there are circumstances, our lives go through circumstances. If we wait a little bit, it changes back. But when there is a season, it's not just something that you wait and say, oh, by tomorrow it will be different. No, it's a big transformation. It's a big epoch. And so when we say that God is changing a season, you can't wait it out. You can't say, oh, God is changing it, but I will stay where I am. Hopefully, the world will return to where it was. It will not. And that's just something I want all of us to understand. What is happening in this world is bringing about a change in season. It's a seasonal change, not circumstance change. So for those of us who are waiting that things will get back to normal, then the normal will not be the normal you are used to. So we have to know when there is a change in season. And today I just want to talk about a similar thing that happened in Israel when there was a change in season. And it occurred when Saul, King Saul, died. Saul had been king of Israel for 42 years. His reign had been a bit turbulent. The people's spiritual life had deteriorated. He himself at a point was consulting witches. And so the nation is in a bad shape. And it had been so for about 42 years. They were losing battles. But God had indicated that David was going to come as the new king. David had to wait for years for that day to come into manifestation. And then Saul dies in battle, and now there is a change in season. The seasons are changed. Something that the people had done for 42 years is about to change. And if you were an Israelite at that time, if you lived under a king who has been king for 42 years, he will probably be the only king most people knew. And his style of leadership is all that they knew, and the conditions were all that they knew. Now, David is coming. I want you to watch something that happens when this change of seasons is taking place in 1 Chronicles chapter 12. 1 Chronicles chapter 12. And in 1 Chronicles chapter 12, generally, the passage is talking about the armies of Israel that came to ensure that this change in season happens. And I want you to pay attention. 1 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 23, and then later I'll read verse 31 to 33. 1 Chronicles 12, 23. Now these were the numbers of the divisions that were equipped for war. I want you to note that phrase carefully. Equipped for war. And came to David at Hebron to turn over the kingdom of Saul to him according to the word of the Lord. They came to turn over the kingdom of Saul, not the kingdom of Israel, the kingdom of Saul to David, because leadership is shifting from Saul, the house of Saul, to the house of David. And so these people came, and the Bible says they were equipped for war to ensure that the change in season occurs. Now, you jump to verse 31 to verse number 33. And it says from verse 31, of the half tribe of Manasseh, 18,000 who were designated by name to come and make David king. Verse 32, of the sons of Issachar, who had understanding of the times to know what Israel ought to do, their chiefs were 200, and all their brethren were at their command. 33, of Zebulun there were 50,000 who went out to battle, expert in war and with all weapons of war, stout-hearted men who could keep ranks. Now, if you read earlier in the context, each tribe is mentioned and the number of people who went and the weapons they carried. And so these were military people who were going to ensure that this change of season happens. And they go to make David take over in this new season. But then in verse 32, a tribe is mentioned, and they don't have weapons of war. They are not military men. They don't have a shield. They don't have a sword. They don't have spear. Everybody's carrying a spear. But the only thing they have, the Bible says that they had understanding of the times. Understanding of the times. So their weapon, what they went into battle with was not spear and sword and shield, but they went with an understanding of the times. There are moments in warfare where spear doesn't do the job effectively, but understanding does the job effectively. And that is what the people of Issachar understood, that this is a change in season. You don't just go with weapons of war, you have to go with understanding of the times. And it's very interesting that of all the major tribes of Israel, Issachar should be the one who has understanding of the times. I mean, David's tribe is Judah. The Bible doesn't say they have understanding of the times. There is Benjamin, there are the Levites. All of them have weapons of war, but Issachar has understanding of the times. The meaning of Issachar, the name Issachar, means one who is paid to serve, or wages, paid wages. And it came about because of how he was born. Issachar's mother was Leah. And if you know your Old Testament a bit, Leah was the wife of Jacob that Jacob didn't love. And unfortunately or fortunately, the one who was not loved was the one who was giving birth. So Leah started giving children to Jacob, gave birth to Reuben and Simeon and Levi and Judah. At that time, Rachel, who was the loved one, came to negotiate with Leah, and I'm not going to go into that negotiation, but the negotiation took place, and her maids gave birth. And then afterwards, Leah goes and says, well, I need to come back for my husband. So Jacob comes back to Leah, and in the process, Issachar is born. And so Issachar is like the wages or the reward for the service that had been provided. So all that you can say is that his birth was not a glorious one. He wasn't born under very noble circumstances. He was born under very shady, dicey circumstances. The first thing to note about Issachar. The second thing to note about Issachar is what his father said about him. Jacob said about him. Jacob said in Genesis chapter 41, verse 14 and 15, when he's speaking about all his children and their descendants and blessing them, curiously, listen to the blessing he gave to Issachar. Genesis chapter 49, verse 14 to 15. Issachar is a strong donkey, lying down between two burdens. He saw that rest was good, that the land was pleasant. He bowed his shoulder to bear a burden and became a band of slaves. Jacob predicted that Issachar would be a tribe of slaves. The father says he's a strong donkey. All he knows how to do is to bear burden. And when they get to the promised land, he will see that the land is good and he'll be a slave in the land. So if you look at this guy, his birth is very shady. The negotiation wasn't a nice, decent one. His father's prophecy concerning him is that he's going to be a slave. But in this passage, he is not a slave. He is actually providing guidance and leadership. And the Bible says he had understanding of the times. So something happened between what Jacob said should be the destiny of Issachar and the reality of Issachar. His father says he's going to be a band of slaves. Here in 1 Chronicles chapter 12, they have understanding of the times. That simply means sometimes what is determined about you can be changed by you. Sometimes what has been spoken concerning you can be altered. And in this moment of destiny, when Israel is shifting seasons, Issachar is the one who has understanding of the times, although Jacob said he's supposed to be a slave. I came to announce to somebody, it has been said about you that you will not make it, that we will be a slave forever. But in this season, a people of understanding are going to emerge from us. So something happened. Now, if you look at the passage carefully, it talks about two interesting things. The sons of Issachar and the heads or the chiefs of Issachar. The sons of Issachar and the heads of Issachar. The heads or the chiefs are 200, but the sons is the whole tribe. When you read through the passage, the whole passage, especially if you look at the root Hebrew words used to describe them, Issachar is the only tribe whose officers are designated by the title heads. The others have leaders, but they are not called heads. Issachar's leaders are called heads. I believe there is some importance to attach to this. They are not heads simply in terms of leadership. They are heads also because they are thinkers. They are heads also because they are thinkers. So out of a band, supposed band of slaves, emerged thinkers. What changed them from the expectation of Jacob for them to be as slaves to where the reality is, where they are leading with knowledge, is because they had a new generation of leaders who were heads, who were thinkers. And it is this group who went out to turn the kingdom over to David. So, it is very possible for people to decree that you will be a slave and you turn that prediction around because you have head. Somebody say, I have head. Say, I have a head. I can think. Because Issachar could think. They had understanding of the times. They could read what was happening. They discerned what was happening. They had clarity of focus about this season of transition from Saul to David. And they knew what Israel ought to do. They knew not only what they as a tribe ought to do, but what the whole nation ought to do. So in a sense, this very insignificant tribe became the influencers of national thought because they knew what Israel ought to do. Very interesting. So what was the consequence of this? If you know what ought to do, then you must do what ought to do. You cannot say, oh, I understand the season, I understand the season we are in, and act in a way that does not conform to the season that you are in. And we see from Issachar, his birth, very dubious. The prophecy by his father concerning him, not encouraging. The reality, very different from the prophecy, because he had understanding of the times. I believe we can rewrite history. We can change outcomes. We can change projections because we have understanding of the times. Now, when you go to verse 40 of the passage we are looking at, 1 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 40, there is something said about Issachar again with other tribes, including Zebulun, that is his younger brother, the tribe. 1 Chronicles chapter 12, verse 14. Moreover, those who were near to them, as far away as Issachar and Zebulun and Naphtali, were bringing food on donkeys and camels. on mules and oxen, provisions of flour, cakes of figs, cakes of raisins, wine and oil, and oxen and sheep abundantly, for there was joy in Israel. An army is gathering to go and make David king, and there are thousands of people. And if you know anything about an army marches on its stomach. They need food. People are happy that the season has changed, but they made no provision. The people who made provision based on the change of season is Naphtali, is Issachar, and is Zebulun. And I can say clearly that I believe that Issachar influenced them, because in this change of season, you must make provision for the season. You cannot say there is change and your action doesn't reflect that. So if there is a change in season, if the kingdom is turning over to David and an army is gathering, then there must be practical solutions provided. And Issachar was right there, providing the food for the army, making sure there's provision, making sure that this enterprise, this assignment becomes a reality. What does that mean to us? It means that knowing that there is a change in season is one thing. Making provision for the change in season is another thing. It's possible for us to theorize and say things are going to change, things are going to be different, but do nothing about it. Make no effort and just hope that just by talking about it, it will be well for us. You know, sometimes you can see something and even talk about it, but not partake of it, simply because you didn't plan ahead for it. So, is there a change in season? I believe so. I believe so. I believe our world is in such a change of season. There is a transition. And this is my conviction. You don't need to believe it, but I believe it. And I believe that if we join together, it will work out well for us. I believe the band of slaves, the band of people whom the world say will be slaves, are coming this time to change the course of history. And they are not coming with weapons of war as others came with. They are coming with understanding of the times. Africa has never been known as a place of knowledge and information and science and technology. We've been known as people with energy, people with a vibrant culture. We dress colorfully. We have art and we have physical structure and muscle. But that era is coming to an end. A new band is coming from this place. Our strength will not be muscle. It will not just be athletics, winning 100 meters and boxing and beating people up. It's going to come because they have head and they have understanding of the times, and they would know what the world ought to do. The people who know what the world ought to do are the people who lead the world. And that, my friends, is where I believe this change of season is leading us. I believe God is bringing us into a new opportunity. And in this new opportunity, those who were condemned or spoken of as slaves are going to come into this season and show direction for the rest of the world. But it's going to come because they have heads. They have heads. May God give you understanding. Somebody put your hand upon your head and say, Lord, give me understanding. Lord, give me understanding. May God give you understanding. May God give me understanding. May God give our nation understanding. I want Ghana to be a nation of understanding. I want Africa to be a continent of understanding. I don't want our greatest achievement to be athletics, sports, boxing, wrestling. Our greatest achievement should not be giraffes and lions and elephants who live on our continent. Our greatest achievement should not be what nature gave us. Our greatest achievement should be what understanding has given us. Men of Issachar, men of Ghana, women of Ghana, the seasons have changed and God is bringing us heads of understanding in our homes, in our businesses, in our churches, heads of understanding. That is what changed this group. They moved from a group without a positive destiny to a people of a positive destiny, a people of a clear destiny, a people who went out and made a difference. And I don't know about you. I believe we can also rise like Issachar. Nobody expected much from us. Not much is said about it. In fact, when you read through the Bible, not much is said about them. But in this epochal time, this major transition in the life of Israel, they stood tall because they had understanding of the times. And may God give us people of understanding. They recognized the significance of the time they were in. At the beginning of this COVID pandemic, I said this season is set up for our continent. It is set up for the shifting of kingdoms. The shifting of kingdoms. People who have been hewers of wood and drawers of water, slaves to the world, are going to shift back into gear because there is something happening here that is going to equalize and level the playing field in our world. And if we go in with understanding, we are going to turn over this world into the direction it should go. And I pray that Africa will not miss the day of visitation. It cannot be business as usual. We cannot just use muscle power to win the battles of life. We cannot use brute force to win the battles of life. We're going to use delicate thought, delicate thinking, clarity of thought, clarity of understanding. And that's one of the things I want to speak to every Christian. It's great that we pray. We pray a lot. And during this time, all of us have prayed. We just finished our 40 days of power. Some have done 30 days, 21 days, 7 days. Some have praying and fasting and praying and praying and praying. And it's great to pray. But as we pray, the number one thing that we should be praying for is understanding. And if our prayer becomes, Lord, give us understanding. Give me understanding. Give my pastor understanding. Give my father understanding. Give my mother understanding. Give my children understanding. If that becomes our obsession and preoccupation, eventually we're going to see the answers to prayer of understanding of the times. People who know what ought to be done at every time. We are the new Issachars of our generation. You are the new Issachars. God will give you understanding in whatever field you are in whatever industry you participate in whatever effort you are in. If you are a pastor, that's your field. But if you are not a pastor and you are an industrialist, that's your field. If you're a farmer, that's your field. If you're a doctor, that's your field. If you're a lawyer, that's your field. Whatever field you are in, we are not just supposed to be low-level players in the world. God has ordained us to be top players. And the key to that is to be like the people of Issachar. They had understanding of the times. They went into battle simply armed with understanding. Can you imagine that? If you were in that battlefield and you saw people with spear and sword and some with all kinds of weapons of war. And then this one tribe comes. They are holding nothing. And you ask them, where is your weapon? It's in our head. What are you going to fight with? It's in our head. You would look at them and despise them and think, oh, they've lost it. They don't even know what the battle is. But the Bible says they knew what Israel ought to do. In other words, they became the leaders of thought of the whole nation in that particular season. It is possible to win with understanding. It is possible to win with knowledge. It is possible to win with wisdom. And may God cause you to win. May God cause us to win. May the Lord lift us up to the place where in this battle, in our world, we become leaders. If you're ready to be part, just stand up wherever you are. Stand up in your room. If you're in a hotel, stand up. If you're in a hospital and it can be permitted, stand up. Just stand up. Standing up is a sign of alertness. And lift up your hand wherever you are. Lift up your hand. If you're driving, you can park your car and lift up your hand. And just talk to God. And just tell him, Lord, in this season, may I become a major player in the world. In this season, may I become a major player in the world. A major player in the world. If you are in trade, you must be a major player in trade. If you are in agriculture, you must be a major player in the world. Not just in Accra or Ghana or whatever town you are in, but a major world changer. Because in this season of transition, the hand of the Lord is upon you. Just talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Talk to the Lord. Ask him to make you a major player. And ask the Lord to open your eyes to opportunity. COVID is an opportunity. It has caused havoc. It has caused pain. It has caused deaths. But within it, there is opportunity. And if we keep our eyes only on the havoc, we never see the opportunity. Just pray and say, God, help me to see the opportunities. Help me to see the doors you are opening. Help me to see what you are doing. Help me, Lord. Help me to never miss it. And now I want you to put your hand upon your head. And I want to pray with you. Father, I pray for everyone at the sound of my voice. As you did for Issachar. With a dishonorable birth. And with a damaging prophecy upon his life. At the crucial time he rose up with understanding. And I pray for everyone whose hand is upon their head, that in this crucial time of world history, you will overturn the negativity of their past and give them understanding for this season. And may you cause these men and women to break barriers, to break chains, to break the yoke of slavery, to break inferiority, to break limitation. May you be breakers in your generation. And may the Lord use you mightily and powerfully in your time and in your season. In Jesus' name. Amen. And amen. And amen. And if you believe that, why don't you celebrate the Lord and thank him for the release of his spirit upon you. May the Lord bless you with understanding of the times. It's a new season, and we are right there in this transition as change makers, as leaders of this change. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated wherever you are. We're going to take our offering, and I just want you to give generously as the Lord has blessed you. One of the ways to Worship God is in your giving. You can worship God with your mouth, with words, with dancing, with singing, with clapping. But none of it costs much. Saying something with your lips, I love you, doesn't cost much. Clapping doesn't cost much. But when we worship God with something that is meaningful, that something that cost us something, something that makes us feel that something has left us. So give with that understanding that it is your worship to the Lord. It is an expression of your faith in God. And the band will minister to us as we receive this offering. God bless you.
Time with Pastor Otabil brings us scriptural perspectives to the critical issues of life.
Anybody who takes time to study the African church, the indigenous African church of the last 40 years, and see the drive that has created the movements that we see, would see a model that, if applied to business and if applied to industry, will transform this country.
Join us online and on air this Tuesday for a discussion on the Builder's Mindset. Time 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. this Tuesday on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, YouTube, my ICGC app, centralgospel.com, and on Max TV and Star Times TV, 10 p.m. on Praise TV, and on Wednesday at 1:30 p.m. on Joy News TV.
Praise God. Turn to your neighbor, your sibling, somebody next to you, tell them it's a new season and it's a new day. We give God praise for the entrance of his word. Why don't you put your hands together in the comfort of your home as we thank God for his word that has come to us. On behalf of Dr. and Mrs. Otabil, I want to say a big thank you to you for joining us in this service. Let's appreciate you, especially if this is your very first time of joining us here at the International Central Gospel Church, whether in person or online. We trust that you've been blessed by the service. Join us again next week, Sunday, online from 7:30 a.m. till 9:30 a.m. or in person here at Christ Temple from 10:30 a.m. till 11:30 a.m. After the benediction, please stay with us as we interact based on God's word. Let me say a big thank you to our media partners for helping us to reach out to you with God's word. Thank you to TV3, Joy News, GH1, ETV, Coastal TV, Metro TV, Max TV, and Star Times TV on radio. Want to thank YFM, Happy FM, Ultimate FM, and Empire FM, and a special thank you to KNET for sponsoring the satellite link for this broadcast. It's time to receive the benediction. Why don't you rise to your feet as you welcome Pastor Mensah Otabil to lead us in the benediction.
Let's receive God's blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon you and give you his peace. The Lord establish you in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. The Lord make you the head and not the tail. The Lord cause his goodness to go before you. This week, may the Lord grant you understanding and clarity of vision in all that you do. May you be like the sons of Issachar, going to battle with wisdom and knowledge and insight and understanding. And may the Lord turn over kingdoms unto you. May the Lord cause you to possess the season and be ahead in this season. And this week, may you experience supernatural help and favor from the Lord in Jesus' name. And go from this place with this confidence and assurance that in Christ Jesus, you are more than a conqueror. Amen and amen. God bless you. Have a great week, and we'll see you next week.